While most news this past year has been centered around the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic, North Korea has been actively strengthening their military power. On October 10, 2020, North Korea revealed their enhanced WMD capabilities at a military parade commemorating the 75th anniversary of the Workers' Party of Korea. With Biden's incumbent presidency, there are a number of concerns and unanswered questions as to how the U.S. will approach the North Korean nuclear crisis moving forward. Past administrations have adopted varying strategies when dealing with North Korea. The Clinton administration responded to North Korea's intentions to withdraw from the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty with the agreed framework in 1994, which consisted of U.S. subsidies in return for the DPRK steps toward denuclearization. The agreement did not last, however, due to lack of confidence between the two parties. Bush and Obama largely took the malign neglect or strategic patience approach, which can be summed up as largely ignoring the North. This approach assumes that North Korea will come to the table on its own when the regime goes belly up. But according to Dr. Siegfried Hecker, an internationally recognized expert in plutonium science, global threat reduction, and nuclear security, neither regime change nor internal collapse were or are imminent in North Korea. Merely waiting will not give the U.S. and allies an upper hand in negotiations. Trump was the first U.S. president in history to meet a North Korean head of state. However, Trump did not have a specific policy and walked away from the Hanoi summit, stating that Kim made impossible demands, which the North rebutted. Yet, according to Professor Chung-in, an expert on U.S.-North Korea relations and nuclear issues, President Trump's approach has merit for bringing Kim to an international forum of its hermetic state.
I personally believe President Trump did a really good job. He was able to bring, Chairman Kim Jong-un to international fora and had meaningful discussions. But problem with President Trump was that he didn't back it up with a working level or practical level solutions.
Since Joe Biden was declared winner of the 2020 U.S. presidential elections, many have begun to speculate how the president-elect will approach his foreign policy. Although he has promised to strengthen alliances and renew American leadership, not much has been said about the North Korean nuclear issue. According to former U.N. High Representative for Disarmament Affairs Angela Kane, Biden would more or less continue the policy of previous administrations prior to Trump.
And that means tighten financial pressure, strengthen ties with South Korea and Japan in particular, and get China to comply with UN sanctions.
She noted that nominating Antony Blinken as Secretary of State is a promising move by Biden.
Tony Blinken actually worked on the North Korea file under the Obama administration, and I think that that is very helpful because he does not come in having to work up the file, but he's already very familiar with it, in any case, how it was under the Obama administration. And he himself has apparently made a statement that he would be open to diplomacy with North Korea, which I think is very encouraging.
According to Moon, there are three contending views within the Biden camp: the denuclearization approach, the arms control approach, and the stable management approach.
First view is so-called denuclearization approach. Their approach is very similar to Trump's approach. North Korea should denuclearize first, then we'll come up with a meaningful reward to North Korea. Therefore, dismantle first, then we will reward. But North Korea is not likely to take that approach. Second approach is what people call the nuclear arms control approach. Even if we cannot recognize North Korean status as a nuclear weapon state, we should be aware of North Korea's nuclear weapons capability. That being the case, then dismantle first, then reward later, won't work. Then what we have to do is we should pursue step-by-step incremental approach, which is based on the simultaneous exchange and the principle of action for action. And I think that is only in a doable approach. But problem is this arms control approach seems to be minority in the Biden camp. Third approach involves those who advocate stable management of North Korean situation through deterrence and selective punishment. But this is very much conditional on North Korean behavior. If North Korea shows patience and self-restraint and does not engage in any kinds of provocative behavior, then Biden administration may come up with a step-by-step approach and may be willing to engage in negotiations in North Korea. But if North Korea just in the test fire, ballistic missiles and undertakes seventh nuclear testing, then the Biden administration will come up with harsh punishment, more than deterrence. And they may even deliberate under military action. That will be nightmares in the situation.
Similar to the second approach that Moon identified, Hecker asserts that developing a simultaneous path would be the best way to approach North Korea.
It is unrealistic to expect North Korea to give up its weapons, in other words, denuclearize first. The much better option is to develop a simultaneous path where the United States, South Korea move towards normalization and a peace process, and North Korea halts and rolls back and eventually eliminates the nuclear weapons.
Experts agree that the biggest challenge for the Biden administration will be to make the North Korean nuclear crisis a top priority among all the many major domestic and international issues the White House must tackle.
I think the biggest obstacle in this particular case is really time. Is this going to have to be tackled right away after President Biden takes over? And I think he has so many domestic issues that he needs to deal with. A very split division in the American people is going to be very, very difficult to heal, the COVID situation. So is this going to be the first file that he's going to attack? So that's, I think, very, very difficult.
Nevertheless, it is clear that North Korea's growing nuclear power poses an existential threat that warrants urgent attention.
I would make North Korea, yes, a very high priority, because I think it gets us into much too dangerous a territory to have a country with such enormous nuclear capabilities with which we don't have a proper relationship or dialogue. And so my advice will certainly be that amongst the security issues, North Korea rates among the very highest.
As tensions continue to rise, the North Korean nuclear crisis should without a doubt be a major consideration for Biden's administration, despite the various efforts of previous presidents toward impeding North Korea's development of nuclear capabilities. The regime remains determined to maintain and build their expanding military arsenal. In the recent Workers Party's 8th Congress, however, Kim Jong-un admitted that his 5-year economic strategy had failed to meet goals in almost every sector. Despite Kim's continued nuclear push, his acknowledgement of the country's economic sufferings may serve as an important point for negotiations.
So what needs to be done is to look at what could actually be done. What could we offer? He's acknowledged the economic difficulties. Could there be a way of entering that way to sort of say, we would like to help the population?
Moving forward, we can only hope that Biden will take into account the failures of prior administrations and pursue confidence-building measures towards a more peaceful, nuclear weapons-free future. Through advice from experts and lessons learned from past failures, perhaps Biden will be able to build back better relations with North Korea.